After watching yesterday's PlayStation 5 spec reveal and giving the details some thought overnight, there was a lot of interesting things discussed yesterday. But I can see that a lot of people in the gaming community aren't particularly happy. There's a lot of discussion going on. Some people are saying that the PlayStation 5 absolutely bombed, that this announcement was, just an admission of defeat, basically. Others are saying that the PlayStation 5 is going to be the superior console. You've got PC gamers just sat there laughing at everybody, and Nintendo gamers, they're not even really noticing what's going on. They're just too busy sat there foaming at the mouth in anticipation, waiting for Animal Crossing to finally turn up. Now, I can see where a lot of people are coming from. It was, from a gamer's perspective, slightly underwhelming if you don't do any of the tech side of things, or don't really care about that. You're just interested in games in your heart, game on the screen, you're just playing, that's what you're interested in. There wasn't much for you in that conference yesterday, so I can see why there's a lot of, I don't know how to describe it, like apathy, really, something like that. However, people need to realise that this conference was originally intended for the cancelled GDC 2020, which is a developers conference. It was intended to be released to the developers, and they've just kind of let us have a look at it, given the current circumstances in the world. I reckon we probably weren't going to get, a reveal of any kind, really, until probably the summer. But we'll see if that bears out now. I mean, you never know, they might speed things up a little bit with the fact that everyone's stuck inside and just sat there waiting to be marketed to. But anyway, what I wanted to do here is just break down the reveal and compare what we found out to what we already know about the Xbox Series X, the different approaches that each developer seems to be taking, and what this could mean for the next generation of gaming and moving forwards from there. Straight off the bat, it does seem on the surface of things that the Xbox Series X is going to have slightly more power than the PlayStation 5 in quite a few ways. Now, the CPUs are nearly identical, with a slight advantage going to the Xbox Series X. The PlayStation 5's 3.5 GHz processor is going to be running at a variable frequency. Now, what this means is that the power draw of the console is going to remain consistent, so you won't see any spikes in heat or power. You shouldn't, hopefully, have moments where your fan tries to make your PlayStation fly across the living room or anything like that. It should remain consistent. So, on paper, the CPU for the PlayStation 5 could have slightly higher stability, whereas the Xbox could have slightly higher performance, but on the whole, I think the performance is going to balance out based on these two facts. The GPU, again, it's a very similar story. The PlayStation 5's GPU comes in short of the Xbox Series X's 12 teraflop count, with the PlayStation 5 being at around 10. But again, it runs at a variable frequency, meaning that the power draw will remain consistent, and it should, in theory, enable more stable performance in comparison to the Xbox, where when it's running at higher load, it could see a bit of a strain on the cooling solution in the Xbox Series X, which could then in turn impact performance. So only time's going to tell on that one. The number of compute units in each of the consoles is different. With the PlayStation 5, it's 36, whereas the Xbox has got 52 compute units. The PlayStation were quick to make the point that, compute units don't really compare one for one, and that due to the fact that there's 62% more transistors in the PlayStation 5's compute units, it should offset the difference somewhat. And we could, again, from my assessment at least, see very similar performance in each console, with the only difference again coming from efficiency and stability, which on paper it looks like that's what Sony have gone for: higher stability and higher efficiency console rather than the higher numbers. But until we get our hands on the consoles, we don't know. Only time's going to tell. There is a slightly higher frequency in the GPU of the PlayStation 5 as well, meaning that they've got it able to run at the 2.23 GHz frequency, which, as long as it remains stable, which seems to be what they've gone for, it should offset any difference in the number of compute units. Again, meaning that we could still see very similar performance graphically. There's not going to be a massive difference between the two consoles as far as graphics goes. They're both going to be able to do ray tracing. They're both going to have the same sort of power. It's all about implementation, really, and only time's going to tell on that front. Each console seems to be running the same sort of architecture in each chipset. We should see large increases in performance on the whole on both consoles, regardless of which you go for, which, it's great news for everybody. You're not going to have a situation where one console is massively better than the other. You're not going to have one set of fans feeling ripped off hardware wires, which is good news. That's what we want. As with the chipsets, the RAM in both consoles is very similar. Each console uses 16 GB of GDDR6 RAM, but again, the implementation is different. So with the PlayStation 5, the RAM runs at a consistent bandwidth of 448 GB per second, whereas in the Xbox, they've split their memory bandwidth. So you've got 10 GB running at 560 GB per second, which is, impressive, but then you've got 6 gigabytes running at 336 gigabytes per second. Now, the main thing that I take personally from this is that the Xbox is going to have slightly higher performance in some sections where the RAM load isn't particularly high. It's going to be able to offload smaller tasks and systems to the lower bandwidth 6 gigabyte RAM. However, there are going to be some points in gameplay where the Xbox is going to need to utilize over 10 gigabytes of RAM. And once it reaches this point, the RAM's going to be capped at the 336 gigabyte per second rate of the 6 gigabyte section. And what this makes me think is as we get later into the console generation, games are going to be utilizing more and more and more of the RAM as they start to do more and more with the console. So long term, we could see overall that the Xbox Series X is predominantly capped at that 336 gigabytes per second RAM, whereas the PlayStation will be stable at 448. It's interesting. It's going to be another wait and see, and a lot of these things are going to be wait and see. It's pointless everyone going mad now. People are going to go with which console they go with. Personally, I'm going to go with the PlayStation. Other people are going to go with the Xbox. I think people are pretty set in the ways at this point. You know, you're obviously going to have people that flit about in between, but those people are probably going to own both at some point in the generation anyway. So coming to the SSD, the PlayStation comes with a slightly smaller SSD than the Xbox Series X. The PlayStation is going to have 825 gigabytes of internal storage compared to the Xbox Series X's 1 terabyte drive. Now, while the hard drives aren't massively different in space, obviously a 1 terabyte drive would be better than an 825 gigabyte drive. The big difference in the storage for the two consoles isn't really in the size, it's in the speed. So with the Xbox Series X, it's 2.4 gigabytes per second raw, or 4.8 gigabytes per second compressed. PlayStation 5 doubles those numbers with 5.5 gigabytes per second raw, and around 8 or 9 gigabytes per second when compressed, which is a substantial upgrade on what the Xbox Series X is going to be able to deliver as far as load times goes. One thing that I will say though is that each of the consoles having SSDs is just going to be a massive increase to speed. Like, even though the PlayStation is going to have, it's going to be twice as fast as the Xbox Series X as far as load times go, that jump on the Xbox is still pretty substantial in comparison to the previous generation. So on the whole, gamers should be extremely happy that we've moved into the world of SSDs now. As far as expansion goes, we all know that Xbox announced plans for proprietary memory cards that will expand storage by 1 terabyte, and they'll probably do larger versions, I'm going to guess, at some point. In comparison to this, Sony have announced that commercial M2 drives will be used as expansion slots for the PlayStation 5. Now, I'm sure that it won't only be commercial M2 drives. I'm pretty sure Sony will develop, or have already developed, their own M2 cards to fit these slots. But with it being announced that commercial M2 drives that meet the required specifications are going to be usable, it just leaves you to wonder what those required specifications are going to be. What I assume is that he means the high speeds of the internal SSD so that the game experience isn't compromised by using an inferior drive. At the minute, there aren't many M2 cards on the market that hit that 5 gigabyte per second transfer speed, but we'll almost certainly see more in development over the next year or so, especially with this announcement, and we should see them coming in at 2 terabytes roughly, or even higher. So that's going to be very interesting. We shouldn't have storage issues. One thing I will say is that at the minute, the only drives that really come close to this, well, the only drives that hit this 5 gigabyte per second requirement are coming in at around £150-£200, so they are quite expensive. But with more of them being developed, we'll see the price of them kind of driven down over the next year or so. Well, probably from when the console gets about a year into its life cycle, we'll probably start seeing M2 drives dropping considerably, especially at the speeds that you'll require. You'll also be able to use an external USB hard drive, which will be usable for your PS4 games. Now, eventually the PS4 library is going to be fully compatible from what I gathered, with most of the top 100 PlayStation 4 games being ready to play from day one. It's just a case of, you know, I'm assuming patching and support and things like that. So I think a lot of people are getting stressy about this and saying, oh, can't play my PlayStation 4 games. That isn't what I took from this press conference at all. What I took from it is that you will pretty much be able to play every PlayStation 4 title eventually, but they've prioritised the top 100 PlayStation 4 titles because, you know, they're the ones that most people have got. So they're obviously going to prioritise them because a wider range of gamers will be able to play a wider range of games that they own already on the new console. So yeah, I'm not really concerned about that. Over time, we'll see the PlayStation 4 library fully available on the PlayStation 5. The final reveal for the hardware focused on the sound with the new Tempest engine that's been developed. On the PlayStation 4, all of the sound was kind of left to one of the PS4's CPU cores and just kind of dumped on it, whereas on the PlayStation 5, much like the PlayStation 3 back in the day, the Sound has got its own chipset, which allows them to achieve much more in comparison. It'll be interesting to see how the new sound systems kind of play out with different HRTF frequencies and sweet spots that you can sit in and different setups that you can use. And hopefully it's going to add a lot of depth to a lot of the games and experiences that you can have on PlayStation 5. It seems that's what they've gone for with this, you know, trying to add immersion and things like that. So, you know, if it builds on the gaming experience, I'm all for it. All in all, it's very interesting to see the different ways that each have gone about developing these new consoles. So with the Xbox Series X, the focus seems to have been on getting raw power into the hardware, going for the highest numbers that they can in most aspects. Whereas with the PlayStation 5, it seems that they're really trying to achieve high levels of performance and efficiency, as well as pushing the numbers up as high as they feel is reasonable. I also feel Sony possibly are keeping an eye on a mid-generation release again, the same as they did with the PlayStation 4 Pro, where we'll probably see the higher numbers such as more CUs and things like that, but only once they can achieve it in a more stable and efficient manner. Either way, it's going to be interesting to see where the two land on price points. I've got a feeling that the Xbox is possibly going to be a little bit more expensive just due to the fact that they have focused on numbers, and with the larger amount of CUs in the console, that means that they're probably going to have a slightly larger die size, and a lot of the cost in the console is going to be manufacturing these chips. So the larger the chips, the more cost there is. So it's going to be interesting to see where they land. I don't think there's going to be a massive difference in price points, but I predict that the Xbox is probably going to be slightly higher. Now personally, and this is just completely my opinion, and I'm not going to lie, I am 100% in camp Sony and have been since the PlayStation 1. But I do feel like the PlayStation 5, while it's probably not going to have, you know, the peaks that the Xbox is going to have performance-wise, I do think it's going to be the more stable console. And long-term, I do think it's probably going to be the better option, especially with the expansion of using M2 slots, especially with the fact that it's been built for stability, so that even when a game is being exceptionally taxing on the console, it'll only be the frequency of the chips that is changing rather than the power draw that's changing. Whereas with the Xbox, you're going to see, you know, some games are going to cause massive jumps in power draw that could see the console overheating potentially. And we all know what happens when Xbox consoles have heating issues. We've been here before with the 360, which, it honestly makes me think that we're not going to have those issues with the Xbox Series X, because they'll have learned from that mistake. Or at least I'd hope that they'll have learned from that mistake. Overall, I think that both sets of fans can be very happy. Like, if you're a Sony fan, you can be very happy that you're going to get a strong console that's got high numbers. Not as high as the Xbox is, but high numbers. And it's going to be stable. It's going to be consistent. That's the main thing that I'm going to take from this as a PlayStation fan. Whereas with the Xbox, you know, you can be happy that your console is pushing the higher numbers. Try to push the envelope a little bit rather than playing it safe to a certain extent. I've seen a lot of people say that Sony are sort of playing it safe here. It's up to you. It's like I said earlier in the video, I believe, you've already decided which console you're probably going to buy. 90% of us, at least. There's probably a percentage of that hop around between consoles, but most of us are going to buy what we're going to buy, and most of us at some point are potentially, well, not most of us, but a lot of us at some point are going to own both consoles anyway. But yeah, either way, everyone should be happy. I can't see anyone being particularly disappointed. People that are being disappointed and angry about these spec releases, I don't know what your problem is. Both sets of fans are going to get brilliant consoles. But what do you think? What are your thoughts on this? Leave some comments down below. Hit me up on Twitter, hit me up on Facebook. Please do smash a like on the video and subscribe to the channel. And have a great day, and take care, and watch out for that coronavirus thing, because, yeah, it's pretty f***ed up, this. It's getting a bit dangerous. If it delays Final Fantasy VII in any way, shape, or form, I'm going to be fuming. Have a great day.